Hi, my name is Stuart Lynch, and this is the sixth and final video in the iOS Swift Concurrency series. In this video, we're going to see if we can apply the new iOS asynchronous concurrency methods to an Xcode project with a target of iOS 14. This will require Xcode 13.2 or later, and it wasn't until Xcode 13.2 that Apple backported some of these features to targets of iOS 13 or earlier. If you're just jumping into the start of this series, you can download the completed code from the fifth video in this series from the link in the description below. With Xcode 13.2, some of the new concurrency features have been backported to iOS 13. And this is great news because perhaps we realize that by setting our target to iOS 15 only, we're missing out on a lot of users who have not upgraded their phones. We're currently using some iOS 15 specific APIs that we'll no longer be able to use, but I would really like to use this new asynchronous concurrency model. As we're testing again, let's create a new branch. By now, this should be familiar to you. Select the source code navigator, and then right-click on the main branch to check it out. Notice that it is now the active branch. And we're going to branch off of this one right here. So we'll right click and create a new branch, and I'll call it Backport. This time, it created the branch and it checked it out all at the same time. So now it's my current active branch that I can work on. Now this getJSON function in our API service is the completion handler version of our function. And it doesn't use the new async and await concurrency methods that were introduced in iOS 15. In videos 4 and 5 of this series, we changed that to use these new methods. Now, if you've updated your Xcode to version 13.2, you should now be able to take advantage of those new features and projects for targeting earlier versions of iOS. And this is one of the terms target applies to. Switch the application and you'll see both project and target. The target in this sense means which of the Apple SDKs am I developing for? Is it macOS, iOS, iPadOS? Is it a widget kit application or one of many others? If you click on the target and then on the general tab, there is a deployment info section. And here you get to see what the iOS deployment target is. And in my case here, it's set to iOS 15.2. This means that in order to install and run this application on your device, it has to be running iOS version 15.2 or higher. And those who haven't upgraded yet can't run your application. As I said, you potentially may be losing out on a lot of customers. In most cases with SwiftUI, going back to iOS 14 from iOS 15 requires only minor changes depending on what APIs you've implemented, and we'll see that shortly. Going back to iOS 13 is a little bit more problematic because there are more deprecated methods. So I'm going to take the less troublesome path and change my target back to iOS 14 and see what happens and what's going to be required. When we build, we get several errors. And these errors are all saying that a particular API that we're using is only available in iOS 15 and newer. The overlay and alert APIs we use in our code have changed since iOS 14. So we're going to have to revert back to the deprecated versions that were available to us then. It's important to note that deprecated doesn't mean that we are playing with fire. There are many deprecated APIs that have been around for many, many years, so there's no need to panic. At some point, however, in the future though, when you change your target back to iOS 15 or higher, you should change the code again to remove the deprecated versions. If I click on one of the overlay errors, it takes us to that culprit. If you option click in the overlay error in users list view, we get the quick help. And if we scroll down further, we see open in documentation. So let's do that, and we'll see that it's available from iOS 15 on. I know that there's an iOS 14 version, however, because I use it. and it doesn't put our view into this trailing closure. Rather, overlay didn't use a closure at all. So let's remove it. Now the error here is hard to decipher, but if we enclose our clause here in a group, the error goes away. Well, we can repeat that in the postlist view too. So we'll do the same thing. We'll remove the closure and embed it within a group. Let's check out the alert and option click and then drill down into the documentation. I can see that it too is iOS 15 on only. Now, if I search through the documentation and click on the alert that's found, I'm taken to another alert, and I see that it's been available since iOS 13, but that it's been deprecated. It may take several releases for it to actually disappear, and by that time, hopefully you've updated your code to use the more modern APIs. We can see that this documentation is within a section called Deprecated Views and Controls. Scrolling down, we can see the different initializers that were available to us. If we remove this code now, we can start typing .alert. And if we take a look at the options, we can scroll down and we'll see the two earlier versions, and they are marked in gray. That's an indication that they're deprecated or not available to us. However, we can make them available to us. Let's choose the is presented version. And it needs to be bound to something, which is our view model's show error alert. Inside the content closure, we'll need to use what is known as an alert object. And there are a number of options here. The one we want is the one with title, message, both being text views, and an optional dismiss button. For the title, we can use a text view, and we'll just say application error. For the message, we can use another text view with our view model's error message. But it's optional, so we'll no coalesce it with an empty string. And we don't need the dismiss button because, as I mentioned, it's optional, so we can just remove it. We can repeat this process for the user's list view. And I happen to know that that alert is exactly the same, so we'll just copy it here and paste it or replace it with the same version. If we build now, there are no errors. Great. But we really haven't gained anything. What you have now is a project that you could have originally coded using Xcode 12 under iOS 14. If you want to go back to iOS 13, you'd have to do more things like changing the navigation title to a navigation bar title. You couldn't use state object, and there's probably a host of others. So I'm going to stop here, but you can go back as far as iOS 13 with Swift UI. The observant of you will notice that the list style is not complaining about my using .plain instead of using the full instance of plain list style struct that we had to do in Xcode 12. And it appears that the new style options have been backported, so we don't need to do anything to change them. Well, with Xcode 13.2, we learned that the new concurrency methods have been backported as far back as iOS 13. So if we want to update your API fetches to use this new asynchronous version of the URL session data method, we're going to have to implement those new features. And this should greatly clean up our code. Well, it turns out that although Swift 5.5's new concurrency system is becoming backward compatible in Xcode 13.2, some of the built-in APIs that make use of these concurrency features are still only available on iOS 15, Mac OS Monterey, and the rest of Apple's 2021 operating systems. The good news, however, is that we are provided with another method that we haven't looked at yet, and it's a continuation mechanism that lets us retrofit existing code with async await support. And what also is good news is that Xcode gives us some assistance here. If you command click on the function name for our existing completion handler version of getJSON, you get three different options for converting this function to an asynchronous version. And all three will work, but we really would like to understand this so I can code in the future from the get-go. So let's explore the options, and we'll start from the bottom up. If I choose this method, it simply creates a new function that has the same first two parameters, but instead of a completion handler, it's an asynchronous throwing function, just like our new one that we created in videos 4 and 5. No error then calling the new function getJSON, because as we saw in video 4, we can have two functions with the same name so long as the function parameters are different. What this does use is the withChecked throwing continuation that calls our old completion handler function and then essentially maps the continuation into an asynchronous one. That's pretty cool, but now I have two functions to clutter my code, and our view models are still calling the older version with the completion handler and not this version. So let's just undo this and take a look at our second one. If we choose this one, it basically does the same thing as we saw in the previous example, but it makes all of the same changes in line in the asynchronous version of our function with the use of the checked throwing continuation block and adds continuation resume for each of the result enum cases. Now, the errors we're getting here are all related to the function now not recognizing the API error case, since it's not specified in our function parameters. And we can fix that by prepending all of the cases with API error and by removing any unnecessary returns. Still, I have two functions to deal with, and our view models are still calling this older version with the completion handler and not this version. So let's undo once more. Let's go all in now then and convert our function completely so that we only have a single function to deal with. And that's what this first option will do for us. Well, we'll need to fix those return and errors for not knowing what type the error is still, just like we did in the last version. The errors in this file all go away now, but when I build, I get four errors. Well, why is that? Well, it's because now I'm trying to call that old completion handler version that we had before, and it's no longer here. So let's fix that. And this will be a repeat of what we basically did in video 4 when we created the async function from scratch in iOS 15. In users list view model then, let's remove from the fetch users function everything except the first two lines, because we are going to need an instance of the API service and we want to set isLoading to true. But remember, we can now use a defer block right within our function. So after isLoading.toggle, we'll add the defer block. Then we can simply create a do catch block. And then within the do block, we can try and await the return from the API service getJSON function and assign it to our users. And we can fix the error because we need to specify that our function getJSON is now an asynchronous function. In the catch block, we can set showError to true and then set our error message with the error's localized description and that contact information. And then we have to decorate the function with @mainActor to ensure that the function is dispatched back on the main queue. Well, we can copy everything from defer on down here and then go to the postListView model and replace the corresponding part of the getPost function with this same content. Updating, of course, users to posts. specifying that the fetch post function is asynchronous, and adding the at main actor to make sure that we get executed on the main thread again. We have a couple of errors left though, and those are in our views. And that's because in on appear, we're trying to call a asynchronous function. Well, we can't use .task as we did in iOS 15. It's one of those things that didn't get backported. However, you may recall that there's another option. We can use a unit of asynchronous work called a task. So we can embed within the onAppear our content inside a task and await the fetching of the JSON. Finally, then we can go to the postList view and do exactly the same thing for onAppear. We can enclose our actions in an asynchronous task and then await the fetching of the posts. We can build and run now, and all errors will disappear and our application runs. We have successfully backported our application to run under iOS 14 using the new asynchronous methods. Before we ship the app though, make sure that you'll check any warnings the app is giving you, like this one here that we left for ourselves to make sure that the four previews is set to false. Now the last thing I'm going to do is commit any changes to our local Git repository. Well, that's it. Thanks for joining me on this six-part journey, and I hope that you've learned some useful and transferable skills. I want to thank Chris for inviting me to add content to his channel, and I look forward to being able to contribute more in the future. Thanks for watching.